do this. Okay, good evening, everybody. In accordance with the Open Public Meetings Act, PL 1975, Chapter 231, adequate notice of this regular meeting of the Planning Board of the Township of Franklin has been provided. Everyone would please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Councilman Chase, Mr. Houck asked to be excused. We had a water main break, and he's been up for about two straight days. Mr. Steinhauer. Ms. MacGyver.
Here.
Mr. Mettler.
Here.
Mr. Onyaka.
Yeah.
Mr. Pettit.
Here.
Mr. Thomas asked to be excused. He's away on a family matter. Mr. Potasnak. Chairman Ossini.
Here. And so we have a quorum. So let's start with the minutes of the regular meeting from April 15th.
If there's no discussion, I move that we approve the minutes.
Second.
Ms. MacGyver?
Yes.
Mr. Mettler?
Yes.
Mr. Onyaka?
Yes.
Mr. Pettit?
Yes.
Chairman Ossini?
Yes. The minutes from the regular meeting of May the 20th.
I also move the approval.
Second.
Ms. MacGyver?
Yes.
Mr. Mettler?
Yes.
Mr. Onyaka?
Yes.
Mr. Pettit?
Yes.
Chairman Ossini?
Yes. Resolutions, VM Point LLC, PLN 1400018.
I move the approval.
I would second.
Mr. Ivor.
Yes.
Mr. Mettler.
Yeah.
Mr. Onyaka.
Yes.
Mr. Pettit.
Yes.
That's it.
VGS Holdings, PLN 1300006.
Move the approval.
Second.
Ms. MacGyver.
Yes.
Mr. Mettler.
Yeah.
Mr. Onyaka.
Yes.
Mr. Pettit.
Yes.
Chairman Ossini.
Yes. Okay. Clark and Invignulo, May, June, and July retainers for the Planning Board.
Move the
attorney.
Mr. Chairman, can I ask that we also have authorization for the August one in case we do not meet?
Yes.
I'll move the approval for all 4 months.
I will second as amended.
We'll vote. Call the roll. You got to do that.
Okay. Ms. MacGyver?
Yes.
Mr. Mettler?
Yeah.
Mr. Onyaka?
Yes.
Mr. Pettit?
Yes.
Chairman Ossini?
Yes.
Thanks, guys.
Okay, so discussion. Who's going to talk about this ordinance there?
Mark? Very, very briefly. You've had this about 3 or 4 times now. You did the master plan. You prepared the ordinance and recommended it to council. They introduced it. It is now been sent back to you. It is exactly as you recommended to them, and it is sent to you for the formal referral per the municipal land use law for its consistency with the master plan, which it obviously is since it flowed directly from a master plan update.
That's very concise. Do you need a motion?
Yes.
Okay, I move that we approve for final council approval the ordinance 4115-15.
Second the motion.
Mr. MacGyver?
Yes.
Mettler?
Yes.
Mr. Onyaka?
Yes.
Mr. Pettit?
Yes.
Chairman Ossini, and Councilman Chase has arrived. Councilman Chase?
I don't know.
Okay, that's fine.
I'll vote yes.
That's fine.
We'll be good.
Be a raise.
That's fine.
All right, we're good. Petition of the Township of Franklin for declaratory judgment. Pete?
I'll take this one. Just to update the board on where we stand, as you know, there was a new ruling regarding affordable housing obligations. There was a filing deadline of July 9th, I believe, for the township to file a verified complaint indicating that it was a participating municipality with Council on Affordable Housing at the time that the latest third round rules were declared void by the court. That complaint has been filed. Presently, what will happen is the township and the courts will then, excuse me, upon filing an application, there'll be a 5-month period for the township to then file its amended plan with the court and seek approval. During that period, the township will have protection against a builder's remedy lawsuit. And that's kind of where we stand. Frankly, I'm not sure that all the courts had a framework in place for how to handle these when they were filed. So I think some of this is being essentially put together as we speak by the courts as to how they're going to handle these. I know in Middlesex County, where my office handled the application for Piscataway Township, the judge has already established a procedure, but I'm not sure the same is in place in Somerset County.
So, and the bottom line is, as Peter said, we have 5 months to file a plan. We've already done the plan, following the advice of our township attorney as to, you know, exactly when we should file things and what we should file. Basically, we have done everything we can do at this point, and we'll be filing our plan at the appropriate time.
Okay, good. Thanks for the update. So just a little housekeeping. So we got a number of hearings tonight. The 600 Franklin Boulevard hearing, which is scheduled third, the attorney representing that is the Sayreville Planning Board attorney, and so he's there at their meeting. It has to be. If we proceed fast enough, we're going to move up Orton and Piersanti and move 600 Franklin to the back of the line. So without further ado, Bank of America. You sit at the desk, yeah. And so how many witnesses do you have?
Only one.
Okay, so
we love one witness.
I love it, yeah. So you know what? You can go and have him sworn in, introduce everything, and tell us about the application. Then we'll just go right to the staff reports, in which case he most likely will continue to respond to those. And that should be the way things go.
You could sit at the table.
Yeah,
have to
by all means, please.
Feel a little taller when I stand.
Fair enough.
So, go ahead.
Want me to swear, man?
You want to say something first?
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, board members. My name is Diane Hickey of the law firm Riker Danzig, here on behalf of the applicant, Bank of America. This is an application for site plan approval to install a drive-through ATM in the existing parking lot of John's Plaza, located at 712 Hamilton Street in Franklin. I have, as I mentioned, one witness here with me tonight, Matt Welch of Stonefield Engineering. Should we proceed to swear Matt in?
Yeah. Go ahead.
Sure. Do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
And could you state your name, spell your last name, and give us your professional address for the record?
Matthew Welch, W-E-L-C-H. I am a senior project manager at Stonefield Engineering and Design, located at 75 Orient Way in Rutherford, New Jersey.
Matt, can you give the board the benefit of your education and expertise?
Certainly. I received my Bachelor of Science in the field of civil engineering from Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute. I'm a licensed professional engineer in the state of New Jersey.
You're accepted.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah, it's a good school.
Thank you.
So, Matt, do you want to start with the aerial exhibit to give the board some context of the property and the application?
Certainly. Yes, this is an aerial exhibit prepared by our office dated July 15th, 2015. North is to the top of the page. It's an aerial depicting the subject property, Hamilton Street, and the surrounding areas. I'll mark this as A1.
A1, please.
Can you also put today's date, which is 7/15? Thank you.
Thank you. So just as a bit of an introduction, essentially this project by Bank of America is to take advantage of some changing technologies which have really changed the banking industry over the past couple years and have allowed a lot more banking to be done at small ATM kiosks as opposed to larger banking centers. And with that, the bank has been able to take these kiosks and really take small portions of existing properties and turn them into new amenities and viable uses. Specifically, this application is proposed within the existing parking lot of the subject property. The property itself is about 8 acres, of which approximately 55% is undeveloped. Within the developable portion is a retail building containing the super tropical food market, the retail, and a couple other uses. It's about 28,000 square feet. Additionally, there's a parking field located to the east and to the north of the building. The property was initially constructed in the 1960s and remained relatively unchanged until approximately 10 years ago when some minor site improvements were undertaken in the easterly portion of the lot, mostly repaving, restriping, and the installation of some landscaped islands. Hamilton Street fronts the northerly portion of the property. It's under Somerset County jurisdiction, and the site provides two full-movement driveways along Hamilton Street, as well as one side driveway with access to Catherine Street. Parking abuts the property line. Additionally, along the site frontage, there's parallel parking on both sides of the roadway, sidewalks, and a number of raised planters, plant beds along the site frontage. The proposed improvements would occur within 11 parking spaces in the northwesterly portion of the property. And I'm going to be referring to our latest site plan prepared by our office. Last revised December 30th, 2014.
Could you use the microphone, please, so it's public?
This is as submitted to the board. Should we go ahead and mark this?
I don't think you need to mark it.
Thank you.
Sheet C4 of that plan set is entitled Demolition of the Site Plans and describe what was initially proposed as part of our initial submission to the board. Essentially, it consists of a concrete island upon which would be constructed one drive-up ATM kiosk and a clearance bar to ensure no large vehicles hit the canopy that's on top of it. It provides stacking of approximately 60 feet, which can accommodate up to three vehicles. Typical turnaround time for transactions at these ATMs average about 2 minutes per transaction. Some are shorter if you're just taking out cash, some are longer if you're depositing checks, but it averages to be approximately 2 minutes. And typically, which has a capacity of about 30 vehicles an hour. Typically, we only see peaks of about 15 vehicles an hour. So the three parking stalls and the space we've allotted for the improvements is certainly sufficient to serve the use. On either side of the drive-through are two islands, which initially were proposed to be concrete islands. However, we've made some alterations to those, and I will get to those in a second. And then lastly, as part of any financial transaction, there's a security element involved. People are taking out money, and you know, both the bank and the state want to make sure that it's a safe environment. As of that, the state of New Jersey has actually state statutes which require certain light levels proximate to the ATM. And the bank actually has taken those New Jersey state laws and applied them to their projects nationwide. But in order to meet those light levels, we are proposing six metal halide light poles. They will all be shielded to minimize any light spillage into the Hamilton Street right away and are sufficient to meet the state lighting requirements.
And that's for the benefit of the board. That standard is 2-foot candle within 60 feet within the parking lot?
Yes. So there's two standards that the state requires. We need to be 10-foot candles within 5 feet of the ATM and 2-foot candles within 60 feet of the ATM. And today, there's not sufficient lighting to meet that requirement, but with these proposed light fixtures, we will be able to adhere to it.
And just before we move from the site plan, you mentioned that the ATM is going to be located in, we're gonna remove 11 spaces to locate the ATM?
Correct, and actually that's a decent segue. I have a second exhibit which depicts those 11 spaces.
And Matt, there'll still be sufficient parking within the overall parking lot, even with the loss of those 11 spaces?
Yeah, the existing parking supply exceeds the parking requirement by about 30 stalls. And if you've been by the shopping center, there's certainly no parking issues today. And we would not be creating any variances with the loss of parking. This plan, I'm going to label it as Exhibit A2.
With today's date, please.
Is a picture taken by our office of the existing parking stalls where the ATM would be located. It's entitled Existing Conditions B, dated July 13th, 2015. And in it, you can see the existing parking that fronts the property line, the existing curb stops, and the raised planter beds that front the sidewalk. Exhibit A3, which I will add today's day two, is a rendering by our office depicting exactly what it would occur if you're in the parking lot looking at the ATM. You can see the existing kiosk, the light fixtures, and as a result of some discussions with your town professionals, we do acknowledge in their comments letter there was some comments related to existing landscaping improvements on site. As I mentioned, about 10 years ago, there were some landscape improvements done in the easterly portion of the site, but the westerly portion was essentially left as it is today. We do acknowledge that the landscaping improvements proposed would definitely make the site more attractive. However, the applicant would ask the board to consider a landscaping plan that's more proportional to the scope of development proposed properly. Namely, what we're proposing to do is, instead of concrete islands on each side of the ATM, we will construct landscaped islands with some low-lying shrubbery. We looked at doing some trees, however, we spoke with the bank security team, and they're very sensitive to any large shrubs or trees proximate to the ATM. It's really a safety reason. You need to have an open environment around that ATM. You don't want people hiding behind large trees or in the shadows. So, but low-lying shrubbery on either end of the ATM is something the bank is more than willing to provide. Additionally, at both entrances, there's currently a hatched island as you enter the site. What we're proposing to do is provide a landscaped island inclusive of some shrubberies, as well as a street tree, one on each driveway. So it's certainly not to the extent of your planner's initial recommendations, but it's something that we feel will add some additional aesthetics to this portion of the site and is, you know, proportionally more in line with the relatively small scope of the project.
That's right, and we feel that this landscaping is appropriate considering the scope of the application and is also consistent with the landscaping requirements and design guidelines of the Township Code and the Master Plan.
One last aspect I would like to get to is the sign variances. And I'm referring to, this is Exhibit A4.
A4, please.
Which is essentially it's really the first page of the architectural plan set for the ATM. It's entitled Model UB4B180 Drive-Up Kiosk with Canopy. And essentially a visual representation of the bank's drive-up ATM kiosk. And what you'll notice, the sign on the kiosk is essentially in a red band that's approximately 16 inches tall and wraps entirely around the kiosk. Which essentially creates four wall signs, one on each side, that extend the entire width of the ATM wall. This essentially creates three or four variances, the first being the number of signs. Only one wall sign is permitted based on this. Four wall signs are proposed. Reason for that is somewhat. And most of these sign variances is the uniqueness of the structure. Typically, when you think of a building, it's on a lot. You see it from the street. It's not, and it's rather large. This is a relatively small kiosk compared to what you would normally see. And it's located towards the site frontage, so it can be seen not only from the street, but also from patrons within the shopping center. So because of the multiple views that you have on this structure, we believe it's a benefit to have the Bank of America logo on all four sides. That way anyone seeing the structure can both identify it as an ATM and know that it's a Bank of America ATM. You won't be surprised if you're a Chase member, you pull up, you see a Bank of America logo, and then realize you have to pay an ATM fee. Additionally, we need a variance for the length of each of these signs. The ordinance only allows for 75% of the wall width. Given that the red band extends entirely around the structure, it's we're requesting a variance to have 100% of the wall width. And again, it's more of a both relative to the small size of the structure as well as the aesthetics. Personally, in my opinion, the continuous red band does not propose any aesthetic hindrance to the public, as you would see if you had a relatively large building with a large wall sign that you would be viewing from the street frontage. And the last is a variance for the area. The two longer walls allow for 9 square feet of signage. We're proposing 11.25. And the two shorter walls where we have the logo allow for 3.4 square feet. And we're proposing 4.2, as again, is a function of the small size of the proposed kiosk. That essentially is a summary of the project. Mm-hmm. I'd be happy to.
Mr. Chairman, would you like us to move to the comment letters, or?
Mr. Chairman, let me just, I need to say something very briefly. In a matter of another position I hold as the executive director of the Hamilton Street Advisory Board. As you know, we have an advisory board for Hamilton Street because they gave you the ordinance. Mm-hmm. Their site plan review committee did review this, and they take no exception to the variances. They take no exception to the use, and they take no exception to approving this conditioned upon them complying with staff reports, specifically in regard to the engineering report, which talks about light spillage and making sure that you have the appropriate shields for that, pushing the project back to allow for the landscaping, which is in keeping with the Hamilton Street plan, which also incorporates lessening the aisle width there, which is a safer. So with those conditions, with allowing them to comply with all the staff report comments, they don't take exception and they're in favor of the project.
Okay, well, that's good to know. Before we get to the staff reports, let me just ask if the board has any questions on what's been presented. All right, seeing none, why don't we go through the staff reports?
Sure.
And focus, and I think I know what you're going to have to focus on, but obviously the things that you can comply with, you don't need to bring up.
Okay.
You'll just state that you'll comply with them.
Sure.
The things that you don't want to comply with or want to talk to the board about, we'll focus on those.
Matt, if we want to start, I'm referring to the letter from the board's planner,
mm-hmm.
Dated May 15th. We'll start on page 2. As mentioned by Mr. Dominic, the recommendation that we reduce the internal travel aisle from 40 feet to 26 feet in width.
Yes, and we certainly, again, appreciate the comments and the landscape proposed. However, it's the position of the applicant that the alternative landscaping, and I know I depict the rendering, but it might be easier to visualize in regular plan view. One more exhibit, I think we're on A5. And this is an additional landscape exhibit prepared by our office, dated June 12, 2015. Again, depicts what I spoke with briefly about earlier of having the landscaped islands proximate to the kiosk, as well as the street trees. This is something that the bank is willing to do, and it's something that is, although it's not to the full extent of the planner's comments, it does add some aesthetics to the frontage, and is relatively proportional to the scope of the project. The improvements proposed and recommended by the planner would result in more significant changes to the site plan which is, you know, well beyond the scope that the applicant is willing to see at this time. But I think this certainly adds a number of visual enhancements to the property. It's certainly better than the stagnant parking stalls that are there today. You know, in regards to the 40-foot aisle width, I hear you, it's a bit wider than you would normally see in a parking
lot.
Well,
it's not a bit wider. It's substantially wider than we would ever permit, which is why when we get an application like this, we clean items up like that. And I think you would agree, as I think you represent some boards, that is something that you would never allow to continue unless there was some strange. And we have an opportunity to clean something up, which is we do with the landscaping. So,
well, I guess the major question really becomes, like, you know, moving the whole project back and enhancing the the streetscape. And I'm sure you're aware from reading the township ordinances and codes about you know, the kind of things we're trying to do to enhance Hamilton Street. And so, you know, we're particularly sensitive to that. But you mentioned that your client didn't want to comply. And I guess I would only ask why, since, you know, maybe there's a reason.
Well, it's not that they don't want to comply. You know, the position is we want to propose something that's relatively proportional to the scope of the project. If there was a much larger site improvement that we were proposing, then we would expect to undergo more significant landscaping improvements as a result of the project. But given the relatively small size of this kiosk, the fact that we're only taking up 11 parking stalls, you know, I certainly think the landscaping that we're proposing is relatively in scope with the proposed improvements.
I mean, I don't know that it's the amount of landscaping so much as the fact that the project is much closer to the streetscape than we'd prefer. And if you brought that back and reduced the aisle width, then you'd have something much more in scale with this. You know, we're trying to get things not to be, you know, right up on the street like that, to give some, you know, the landscaping in that should be enhanced with some street trees. Moving the project back would allow you not only to do that, but to still fulfill the sort of security concerns, because you'd have room for the landscaping up closer to the street. You'd have room between the end of that landscaping and the actual kiosk, and you'd have, you know, plenty of room to, you know, answer the security concerns. But, you know, I think you've heard from not only, you know, Vince and Mark, but I think the board would be in agreement that, you know, we really do want the streetscape standards adhered to. And I'm certain you can appreciate that if we were to vary it for you, there's probably no reason why other people might not come in and ask.
And Mike, you know, when we were talking about in proportion, the staff had the conversation about that, where we did not ask them, or the staff reports do not say fix the aisle widths and the rest of the parking lot and do everything else. We felt it was appropriate and commensurate with this application that they want to put something on the street, that they take care of the streetscape and that first aisle. So I would argue that this is extremely commensurate with what's being done, and in fact is overly generous, because many boards would make them fix the whole entire site instead of being commensurate. So I would argue in the opposite.
I think the other issue too is, well, I mean, we talked about the aesthetics, having a vehicular intensive, you know, drive-through use right on top of the sidewalk, but then, you know, it is going to draw more traffic into the site, and there's already a traffic-related, circulation-related issue with the site, and these improvements would address that. So it's not just aesthetics; it's also traffic circulation that we're addressing.
Well, in regards to the,
go ahead. I'm sorry.
No.
I just said, you know, while we appreciate the bank's desires, we have our own desires. We're trying to improve Hamilton Street. Having this thing out on a street on the corner is not improving Hamilton Street, in my view. We have a group of people who have spent a lot of time. He's their chairperson. They don't want it. They want it the way we're suggesting it to you. And basically, I mean, should be able to read the handwriting on the wall.
And again, we certainly appreciate what the town is looking to do. But I mean, right now you have all stagnant parking stalls right up against the property line. You have cars that are essentially sitting here all day. What we're doing is adding in a use.
Yeah,
we're adding some activity.
The stagnant
we're adding some
parking
life.
Lot problem is our problem. We don't have to exacerbate it by putting something else in the way that we have to move back or get out of the way. We know what's there. That's part of the whole process of trying to improve the streetscape, if you will, of Hamilton Street.
My suggestion would move on to other, I think you heard what the board is going to want, and when we get to the idea of for a motion, I think they're going to make a motion based on that. I would move on to the next topic.
Matt, I think another item we should address in the comment letter is lighting, light levels at the property line.
Yes, so, and I'm going to referring to back to my site plan sheet. This is sheet C7 of the set. It's entitled Lighting Plan. As I mentioned, New Jersey has state statutes that we have to meet, which requires us to light up the 2-foot candles up to the property line. So that's something that we have to meet per state law to create a safe environment for the customers. In order to mitigate light spillage, we've installed lower light poles than are elsewhere on site. The other light poles on the site are 28 feet tall. The higher the light pole you get, the more area of illumination. So we've lowered these down to 18 feet. We've shielded all the fixtures to minimize light spillage into the public right of way. We are at, and sometimes a little bit over, up to 2 to 4 foot candles along the property line. This goes down to a spillage of approximately 1 foot candle along the curb line, and then less than a half a foot candle at the end of the parking row where you actually have traffic driving on the road. In order to determine what impact this would have to Hamilton Street, we went out at night and actually did a light study to see what levels are out there today. And what we found is actually when you're driving along Hamilton Street, the light levels today are between 1 and 2 foot candles and then increase as you get under the existing street lighting. So providing only a half a foot candle of light spillage onto the road compared to what's there today, in my opinion, would not be anything significant or noticeable to
Yeah, and once again, if I think you'll agree that if you went with the staff recommendations and moved it back, the lighting would move back, so there would be less light spillage. So that would also take care of a good deal of that issue.
I'm going to have to disagree with that because we still have to light 2 foot candles up to the property line.
Yes, but I don't believe that's valid because you'd push the lights back, which means the shielding would allow you to have, you may have some light spillage, but you would have less. I mean, we reviewed hundreds of these. That's just not true. You could move the lights in a different manner, so because you have to light at a certain manner right near the building too. I know what the state law says, but you'd move them forward, so maybe you'd be able to lose a half a foot candle. I mean, that's an easy thing for your lighting guy to do.
Well, that's,
he could design it so there would be less light spillage if you move it back, because that's just common sense.
The minimum foot candle on the property line as designed is 2.
Right.
So as soon as we move those poles back, it's going to be less than 2, and we won't meet the state requirements.
But you have areas that are greater than 2, and you can change the patterns of those lights.
And
where you're going to put them.
I did this lighting design myself. I spent a lot of time because I understand the sensitivity of the light spillage. We deal with it on every single Bank of America project. You know, this is not the first ATM. When the bank builds these standalone kiosks, 90% of the time, it's in the front of a shopping center exactly like we have. And 90% of the time, we're dealing with light spillage into the right of way. So this is something I work extensively on. I've worked on 30.